Foreign currency transactions. This topic, number three, it's on hedges. Hedging is the process of undertaking some activity to mitigate the risk of loss from the same or another activity. Fundamentally, we are mitigating risk or we're transferring risk to another party. In finance, hedging often refers to purchase of derivative products that transfer the risk of a particular transaction to another party. Hedging is different, however, from hedge accounting. Hedging refers to the idea of mitigating or transferring risk, where hedge accounting refers specifically to the practice of accounting for hedging transactions. Let's look at an overview of hedge accounting. Hedge accounting is covered by IFRS 9, and it sets out the standards for hedge accounting. I need to emphasize here, hedge accounting is optional. It is a system by which an entity is permitted, but not required, to defer or accelerate income recognition in order to show that some of the gains or losses on a hedged item are being offset by the hedging position. So basically, what a company can do, elect to use hedge accounting to match, I hate using that term under IFRS, but I guess to pair up the economic reality that there is a corresponding gain or loss from a hedging instrument, which is directly offsetting a corresponding gain or loss from a hedged item. There are some requirements. So if a company chooses to use IFRS 9 hedge accounting, hedge accounting under IFRS 9, then they must meet three conditions in order to use it. The first is that the hedging relationship consists of only eligible hedging instruments and an eligible hedged item. It must be declared at the inception of the hedge. There must be a formal designation and documentation of the hedging relationship, as well as the entity's risk management objective for the strategy for undertaking the hedge. And then number three, the hedging relationship must meet the hedge effectiveness requirements. Let's look into that part a little bit more now. Hedge effectiveness. This is defined to further assist accountants to determine if they are meeting the requirements for hedge accounting that we just discussed. Hedge effectiveness is the extent to which changes in the value of cash flows of the hedging instrument are offsets the changes in value of the hedged item. For example, a currency forward being used to hedge might create a $1 gain on contract that offsets a $1 loss due to the actual fluctuation in the currency's underlying value. And in that case, that hedge would be considered to be effective. Hedges are further broken down into fair value hedges and cash flow hedges. A fair value hedge is one that is being used to hedge against a fluctuation in the fair value of the hedged item. Gains or losses on those hedges are reported in income in the same period as the gain or loss of the hedged item. There is an exception to this if management has elected to push these gains or losses into OCI and they're recognized through OCI. A cash flow hedge is one that is used to hedge against fluctuations in the Canadian dollar value of future cash flows. This type of hedge has its gains or losses reported in OCI and then recycled into income when the underlying hedged item's gain or loss is recognized in income. So basically, you can have a fair value hedge, or you can use cash flow, buying and selling future cash flow forwards in order to hedge against introduce hedging against a hedged item. Let's look at an example. Which of the following scenarios does not describe hedging? A, a company purchases a currency forward to offset any gain or loss on a US dollar. B, an individual purchases health insurance and then purchases disastrous claim insurance to cover any loss not covered by the original policy. C, an individual places a bet on two opposing fighters in a UFC fight. D, company purchases a number of shares in a supplier as investment. Who would have thunk it? The answer is D. D does not represent a hedging scenario. Each of A through C do demonstrate a scenario in which an individual is undertaking activity that mitigates or transfers risk of loss. So if you are purchasing a currency forward to offset a gain or loss on a USD contract, absolutely. You're trying to, you know, say, hey, if I get a loss on that USD contract, I'll at least have a corresponding gain from this currency forward. If you buy health insurance, but there is something that's not covered in that you know, original policy, and then you get the disastrous claim insurance for those like black swan events, absolutely. You are mitigating or, you know, really transferring the risk of loss to that disastrous claim policy. And man, you really don't want to lose on that fight, so you bet both sides. Are you going to make any money? No, but it's technically, you know, you've entered into a hedge. You definitely won't lose. So D is not a hedging event where a company purchases a number of shares and a supplier as an investment. No, if anything, you're kind of just doubling down, because like, what if the supplier goes out of business? Then you've lost your money for the shares and you have to find yourself a new supplier. You guys did good. This week was a lot. And thank you. Thank you. Thank you for making it this far. You will notice that all of the items in the last three videos are going to be examinable at an awareness level, meaning no quants outside of anything that you may have seen in a prerequisite course, meaning that the only quant for any of these kind of chapter 10 items would be the transaction gain or loss of just like a regular payable or receivable or debt. That's because when we look into next week, you'll be doing lots more of these. So lots more foreign currency transactions, I'll just leave it there. So that's the only thing. And by the time you get done with next week, you'll be hoping to see it on exam somewhere. Alrighty. Have a good one, guys. Talk soon.